Good afternoon, everyone. I want to thank you all for joining us today. It's a privilege to come together as a community here in Riggs Library to remember a dear friend, colleague, longtime member of Georgetown community, Carol Lancaster, to have this opportunity to honor her legacy. And I wish to extend a special welcome to Doug Farrar and other members of the Lancaster family who join us today. It's wonderful to have you with us. One of the extraordinary gifts that comes with being a member of this community for so many years is watching and experiencing the meaning of time, of the enduring engagement and commitment of the members of our community. And we're grateful to have shared this place with Carol, an extraordinary scholar, an author of more than 10 books, an exceptional administrator, a friend and colleague and mentor to so many over the course of her nearly 3.5 decades of service to the university and her more than 5 decades of connection to this place. I think you can all share with me the sense of her own presence here, right now, today. And as I have shared at other moments when reflecting on her legacy, Carol understood global from the beginning. Her areas of study and roles in government service took her to points throughout the world, and her worldview has a distinctly global characteristic. And she brought these experiences and her global worldview with her each time she returned home to the hilltop, deepening her distinctive style of leadership and understanding the possibilities of this place as director of African Studies, as director of the Master's in School of Foreign Service program, as our first director of the Mortara Center, and then as dean. She envisioned with imagination and passion a new way of strengthening our School of Foreign Service. She provided extraordinary leadership in her role as dean, inaugurating 2 new master's programs and launching the Georgetown Institute for Women, Peace, and Security. Carol helped us to better understand what Georgetown is, what makes this place special, and she enabled us to be the very best Georgetown that we can be for ourselves and for others. And the same generosity of spirit, that spirit of joy, of wit, of imagination that animated her work in our community, animates her final work, A Song to My City, Washington, D.C., which we want to celebrate today. The book is a love letter from Carol, a third-generation Washingtonian, to our city, and largely written during the time of her illness. It was later completed by her son, Doug, a fellow Washingtonian and a graduate of our School of Foreign Service. Doug currently serves as a senior manager at the Aspen Institute and has extensive experience in public policy and communications, and we're profoundly grateful to Doug for his extraordinary efforts, and we look forward to hearing his reflections in just a few moments. And joining him in conversation, we have Ambassador Melanne Verveer, Executive Director of our Institute for Women, Peace, and Security, Gail Griffith, former Georgetown Administrator and Director of the Jesuit Refugee Service USA Global Education Initiative, who previously served as Director of External Relations in our School of Foreign Service from 2012 to 2015, and Professor Maurice Jackson of our Department of History and a longtime active member of the DC community, all of whom worked with Carol here at Georgetown and with Doug on this book. In A Song to My City, Carol observes, cities are shaped by many things. Once in a while, cities are also shaped by individuals. Well, Carol is one such individual. She has shaped our university, our city, and our world for the better and inspired all of us to do the same. So again, I wish to thank all of you for being here today. It's now my pleasure to welcome Doug Farrar to offer some reflections and to moderate our panel. Doug?
Let's go up on stage. Thank you. Thanks very much, Jack. Really appreciate you inviting me here, and thanks to the panel for being up here and for all the work you did to get this book over the finish line. As Jack noted, I'm Doug. I'm Carol's son, a double Georgetown graduate with the SFS and School of Continuing Studies degrees. And over the last several years, or the last year since Mom died, we worked together on this book, and it was really a sweet and sentimental thing to do. The book is great. The only true expert of history of Washington here is actually Maurice. So you can learn a lot doing a book like this, but not as much as a professor of history. So I'm wondering if Maurice might be able to first give kind of a view of Washington as my mom over the course of her life here from the 40s through the end of her life in 2014.
Well, thank you, Doug, President Joy and others. Thank you for having me here. You know, first let me just say a word about Carroll. This is a city where big people make themselves important by making other people feel small, where small people make themselves important by making other people feel smaller. Sometimes I go with my wife to parties, and people, the first thing they do is ask you what you do. And of course, she has a good job. So I would say sometimes people ask me, and I say, you know, I'm a school teacher. And when you say it, they walk away. So she says, man, why don't you tell them you're an esteemed professor at the Georgetown University? And I say, dear, if somebody thinks more of me because I'm a professor than they do if I'm a third grade teacher, then I don't want anything to do with them. And it's my motto in life. And the beautiful thing about Carol, that she was small in stature, but she made everybody feel big and important. She had just that about her. The assumption is that all we talked about is Washington, D.C. Well, it is quite not that way. I spent many years traveling all over the world, doing many different things, but I knew the world. And so we would talk about many things. Africa was her field. I knew quite a bit about Africa. I knew many of the liberation leaders and spent much time working with them. So we could talk about many things. The first time I went to the Middle East, actually, was Carol. I went there to work, to teach at the Qatar campus. So it was much more. But we did talk a lot about Washington, D.C. and about the neighborhood. And it taught me several things. First, in writing books, there are complications, of course, and you have these big ambitions. And sometimes you write a book or something, and somebody may say things that maybe you don't like. And then I was thinking about this book, and most times they don't. And I thought about this, and Carol did what all of us should do. She wrote the book that she wanted to write. And that is the most important thing. Second, she wrote a book about her love for the city. Now, I've been here a long time, and I have a love-hate relationship with the city. Every time the city does something right, it turns around and does something wrong. It's the wrong column is winning, I'm afraid. And these are the things that Carol talked about. As she came here as third-generation Washingtoner, lived in Anacostia, probably the only section that has not been totally gentrified, but the illiteracy rate there is alarming. The health disparity rate is alarming. It's about a 30% unemployment in Anacostia. People being shot every night is all over the city. She thought about that. As she talked about her city, she talked about places that had changed. And as she glorified certain changes, and of course, there is very much to talk about as the city with the large buildings and international conglomerates and things come in. But she also lamented the loss of so many. One day this fall, I was teaching a course on Washington, D.C., so I took the students on a tour. And we went to a street, and S Street. We went on S Street. And as we're there, I'm showing them the house across the street where Charles Hamilton Houston lived. Charles Hamilton Houston had been the dean of the Howard Law School, but he'd also been the person more than anyone who established the legal base of around the Board of Education. He did the research. Thurgood Marshall did the auguring, but Charlie Houston did the research. And it's like I joke with people. One time the Washington Post asked me to make a comment about something Maya Angelou said. And I said, the two people I don't mess with, they can say anything they want to. That's Maya Angelou and Big John Thompson. And I don't mess with them. So whatever. So, but the Thurgood Marshall would have been the other one. And so as but then we on the street, and I look across, and there's a barrier. Charles Hampton Houston lived on that street. And then right next door to Carol was the man who taught Arthur Ashe to play tennis, and he had to leave Richmond, Virginia. So this street was made up of just lovely, right in the inner city, and Carol loved her street and her city. I'll end with this, and then we can have much discussion. Sometimes the past can help us a lot. Doug spoke about the 1940s. In 1940s, as we know, the city is quite integrated. Quite segregated. You've got me on that one. In 1946, Harry Truman established something called the National Committee on Segregation in the Nation's Capital. And he brought together Walter Reuther and Hubert Humphrey, who had been the mayor of Minneapolis at the time, and the great lady of all first ladies, Eleanor Roosevelt. And he established this committee called the Committee on Segregation in Washington, a report to the National Committee on Segregation. And he described the city when the public schools of the capital are instead used to divide citizens on racial lines to perpetuate inequalities, to increase them, and worse, to justify them, then the time has come to consider what kind of America we want to build for the future. This is 1946. He commissioned it. The report, 1948, the report came out. 2 weeks ago, a report came out about Washington, the Civil Rights Project, a man named Gary Oldfield. And he said, racial segregation remains high in the city, but isolation in the schools is substantially greater. In other words, many people who live in diverse communities are sending their children to segregated schools. In essence, the city today, in 2017, is more segregated than it was in 1946. How can you imagine such a thing? And these are the things that Carol writes. If you notice the book, she writes about her love for the city at one point, but also the things that hurt her. And these are the things that I worked with Doug on the book, the things that she saw that were happening in the city that should not be. And so the love had a feel of how to make this city greater. This little book is a wonderful look at our city, of its establishment, of its growth. In the end, you'll see that she talks about three great men. She couldn't have picked three different characters, L'Enfant, Boss Shepherd, and Marion Barry. And unlike many, and I knew the man, unlike many, she did not find everything that was wrong. You remember once Bill Clinton said, and I don't quote Mr. Clinton, but he said something that was, I don't quote anybody that often, except the great ones who were dead. So it's not anything on Mr. Clinton. And he said, there's nothing wrong with America that what's right with America can't fix. And I just thought that was a wonderful. And Carol figured that there was nothing wrong with Washington that what's right with Washington couldn't fix. It's people like Carol who fought their whole lives to make something right about the city. Thank you.
I just want to ask one really quick follow-up question before we move on to the other panelists. So much of the book and her view of Washington was influenced by social class and her transition from a working class person with very limited horizons to the dean of one of the most prestigious institutions in the city and the country. How did you, when reading the manuscript and as we worked together on it, feel that that kind of experience influenced her view of the city?
Well, I was quite proud to know Carol. You see, many people rise up and they don't have that attitude. I can't tell you the people who I know in this city who never said a word to me, and then I became a professor at Georgetown. Then it's, but as I joke with them, don't worry about speaking to me as long as my, you know, wife tells me she loves me every now and then. My wife, my children call to check on their mother, I'll be all right. And the dog meets me at the front door, I'll be okay. Don't worry. And President DeGioia signs the check. Everything else will be all right.
Recovered.
But, and it's the beauty, because when I first came to D.C., there were so many working class of white men. And I lived most of my life in Mount Pleasant, and I'd go to the places and sit down and talk with the workers. I was organized and talked. And as many were white, were black. And the guys who did the plumbing, electricity, they were white, who lived in the places that Carol moved to.
Right.
And so she had a fear for those. And I think that Carol is what any working class person wants out of their daughter. You know, I have a daughter. I joke with my daughter, and she called the other day and told me, she said, Dad, such and such, and you know, I'm going to get married in D.C. Well, and I would joke with her, she was little. I would say, well, who you going to marry? I said, I don't know, marry electrician, a plumber, I don't know, whoever. But the thing was and I joke with her, I said, do what you want, dear, but don't bring no pokehead in my house. Now, what I meant is that you strive, and you work with people to strive. And Carol did that stroke. She made people of the working class proud, because this is what you want for your daughters. You want them to grow and to achieve. And Carol did it with such a gusto. And to see a woman of this period, of a period, one of the first, as I understand, to come to Georgetown to break this. Look, if you think the glass ceiling is broke here, you know, I talk to students all the time. And some of the white students argue against affirmative action. And I said, well, I can answer a question in three words. And they say, well, what are they? I say, ask your mama. And what I meant by this, that the struggle for affirmative action helped white women cross the threshold. It is true. There's nothing wrong with it. It's true. And people with disabilities and others, and athletes and others. And Carol represented the best of that, a generation of women who struggled in the post-war years. It was not easy. It certainly wouldn't be easy for a woman like Carol to go to, I think, Bolivia in the 60s. It's a very macho society, and went there, and a small lady, she writes about that. So I think she's exactly what we want, what we encourage out of the daughters and out of young women to get an education.
That's a perfect opportunity to segue to Melanne, who is one of the women who you so eloquently described, a striver, someone who met all these challenges.
In a decent way.
In a good way, in a very good way. So you and my mother first met, I believe, when she was USAID Deputy Administrator on a trip abroad with the First Lady at the time. And I was wondering if you could kind of describe how it was to work with her in government, and how you think government sort of impacted her view of the city and of herself. And also, I'd love some thoughts on the issues that Maurice raised about challenges for women.
Thanks, Doug. Let me say initially the point you last made, I couldn't agree with more, because it was Frederick Douglass, the great abolitionist, who led the women to the Equal Rights Convention in Seneca Falls over 150 years ago, and joined that struggle after his own struggle. So we are all in this together. Carol loved this city, but she saw the warts in this city, and I think the book represents that. There's the good, the bad. She never forgot where she came from. She came from working class neighborhoods and a working class ethos, but she knew what needed to be transformed and to overcome. She loved the neighborhoods. She loved the monuments, but she knew it wasn't a monumental city. That's not why she was so proud to be a third generation Washingtonian. I don't know how many times she told me, you know, I'm a third generation Washingtonian. I say, Carol, I know, you've reminded me so many times. And she wanted to write this book. Of all of her aspirations, this book was in the back of her mind, even when she was finishing her scholarly publications. And even when she was dying, and those moments when she remained lucid, she would say, I worked on my book, or I want to finish this book. There was something about this book that touched her deeply in terms of who she was. And while there are many aspects to Carol, and hopefully we will get through some of them, one is certainly the way that she did move from being a student here in the days when there weren't many women, which I can also remember well, to going global in many ways, improving herself, and then coming back. And really making a mark in the fields that she became vitally interested in and became a great expert in. And what Doug said is true. Very early on, she was the deputy administrator of USAID, our development agency. She was named to that position by President Clinton and confirmed. And early on, the chief of the agency couldn't go on a trip to South Asia with the First Lady. And Carol asked if she could go, and she did indeed go. And it was really the first time I got to know who she was and who she remained for as long as I knew her. She was equally adept at quoting the statistics of Nepal on maternal mortality as she was telling us about the benefits of spicy foods. There was a range of interests that she had, and there was no uppityness. She could have just traveled along and enjoyed all of the more formal aspects of the trip, but long into the night, if I was up as a staff person, she was there to say, what can I do? She didn't have delusions of grandeur. This she never lost, no matter how far she rose. And prior to being at AID, she was a significant official on Africa in the State Department. So Carol had really made her way. But I think one of the greatest contributions she made in government, and one I think a lot about since the current president's budget came out and marked a big zero after USAID in terms of what they'd like to spend on it, was what Carol did at a similarly perilous time for the agency. And it was a time when the then administration was looking to save resources, sort of the benefits of the collapse of the Soviet Union. So there was the struggle within the administration. And then there was the struggle with some of the not so young people in this room will remember with a certain Senator Jesse Helms, who also wanted to end the life of USAID and thought that that could be achieved if they were moved into the State Department. And Carol and Brian Atwood, who was running the department at the time, knew this was wrong. And Carol, who became one of the preeminent experts on development, all aspects of global development, was passionate about this. And having taken this trip to Asia and having bonded and always growing her network, she immediately said, called me and said, do you know what they're trying to do? We've got to stop them. We've got to stop this insidious effort to end USAID. And what she did, because she thought and knew well, she had a friend in the First Lady. She also felt, she and her boss, felt that the memos they were sending on why USAID should not be cut back so dramatically were not reaching the West Wing. And this is not unheard of in White Houses, where different folks in the West Wing have different agendas, and certain paper gets through and certain paper doesn't. But Carol took full advantage of her special relationship, and those memos were transmitted to me, and I, of course, transmitted them to the First Lady. The First Lady talked to the President a great deal. And in the end, USAID never was merged to the state with the State Department in those years. And the untold story, except for those of us who went through it, is that Carol played a singular role in that effort. You know, she always said, my virtue and my vice is that I'm impatient. And she was so impatient on this score. She could not imagine that something that she so internally believed in and championed could be destroyed within the administration and outside the administration. And she went at it. And she became a real expert, not just on the breadth of global development, but particularly at a time when women's empowerment, whether in a girl's education or in microcredit or in economic empowerment, were beginning to seep into the whole development process, and an expertise was growing. And she was deeply committed to those issues and, frankly, to moving the USAID agenda in that space.
I love that story. It's and really representative of this hard-nosed practicality that she carried with her throughout her life, being raised in a sort of a working-class situation. There's one great story from the book, which kind of leads into my next question. So her mother and father were relatively uneducated, just high school. Her mother in particular had sort of limited horizons for what mom might achieve. So she graduates from Georgetown, and her mom says, "Well, time to come home and join the typing pool." And she said, "I instead will take a Fulbright scholarship to La Paz, Bolivia," which, you know, her mom probably had her hair blown back by that comment. But that was what mom did, is blew people's hair back from time to time. So one thing that she was dedicated to for her whole life was the practical efforts and the impact to try to empower women, both at home and abroad in particular. And I'm wondering if you can talk a bit about your work with her on that issue and how passionate she was for it.
Well, she was an extraordinary advocate, and she became an extraordinary expert as well. But one of the things that occurred when she left government was she came to Georgetown in the honorable position that she held here, and she was frustrated in some ways because she wanted to do more on these issues. And at the same time, I was leaving the administration, and we were wanting to further a lot of the work we did. And one of the consequences of that was creating an NGO called Vital Voices to invest in emerging women leaders. And the first person I went to, it's not easy to start an NGO, but we had worked with these women all over the globe, and they were pleading for us to continue and not end those relationships because it said a great deal about their own progress. So I came to Carol, and I said, Carol, can you help us get this started? And she said, well, look here at Georgetown. We've got all kinds of phenomenal faculty members here. I know Pietra Rizzoli's here in the audience. And she immediately went to Pietra and said, you know, you're an expert on these issues from a business perspective. I'm sure you want to help. Recruited others. And before we knew it, some of the earliest trainings we were doing were on this campus, where we would bring groups of women, largely selected by our embassies, and they would come here, whether the topic was human rights or it was economic empowerment, we would tailor the trainings to those programs and those interests. And one day, many years later, I was in South Africa, and a woman came up to me, and she said, oh, you transform my life. I'm a different person. One, couldn't remember who this was, and two, I had no idea what I had done. And it turned out she was from Rwanda, and she had, through the skill set that were transferred to her in this program and a few others, created one of the largest cooperatives for women to make baskets. And these baskets are sold at Macy's, they're sold in many other retail chains, and it is an extraordinary way for women to become economically empowered in this post-conflict society. And Janet went on as she was talking to me, and she said, you know, every day I look up at that certificate on my wall and I thank Georgetown University. And I'm thinking, Georgetown University doesn't even know that certificate is on her wall. Because Carol, believing that it is better to ask forgiveness than permission, agreed that we should give the women something that represented their completion of their training. And so it was the Georgetown Vital Voices certificate. And that certificate hangs in many places around this globe, unbeknownst to this university.
I think we signed Jack's name.
I don't know if we did that.
That's a great story, and sorry, Jack. I just want to turn to Gail now. I don't think it would be unfair to say that when you were at Georgetown with her, she was the boss, right?
Of course.
So my question is, was she as tough of a boss as she was a mom?
Jeez, Doug, I don't think she ever mussed my hair.
Oh, no.
As you were headed to class.
No, I don't think she ever did that.
But I found in her an extraordinary reservoir of goodwill towards the people who worked for her, with her. Everybody knows her vice and her virtue, yes, impatience. I always reflected on her fierce urgency of now. We needed to do it right now, and we needed to do it well, but it had to be right now. And I have to say, in so many ways, she was more like male bosses I have worked for. She would cut through nonsense in ways that, I mean, she didn't do niceties. That's not to say she wasn't charming, that she didn't like to shop and didn't have a thing for Chico's, but she... You know, she cut through a lot of baloney, and that made her fascinating to work for. And she was also an extremely good negotiator and fundraiser. I was in the room when we understood from Coca-Cola that they were willing to allocate monies for the Coke chair that was under the Global Human Development Program. We were so thrilled. And she said, that's a nice figure, but it's not going to do what I need. And he'd offered $3.5 million, and she said, I really need four. And we all know how that ended. But she was a phenomenal boss, and I think that that came from knowing who she really was.
She was the first female dean of the School of Foreign Service and one of the first alumni.
The first alum.
There you go.
To be dean.
And so I wonder, what was her vision like for the school? How did she go about accomplishing it? And what was your view of that when you were there working with her?
Well, she was enormously committed to, as Melanne has referenced, and Maurice, you too, her vision of Washington and the glass ceiling, but her vision to development. And I think that was her bread and butter. I mean, she ate it. She loved it. She was up at 3 a.m. listening to the BBC because that's where she felt she could get the most mm-hmm. interesting information. I think that she took more pride in establishing the program in global development and women, peace, and security than I think anything she had done here. It was interesting to see her progression. I had, before I came, I just sort of run through a timeline of her life, looking at her early days here, and I'd be happy to tell you my impression of what...
I would really like that.
Well,
please.
She was a young girl from Oxon Hill, and she talks about her father who painted houses, and I think that her mother one time rued a comment from the sixth grade teacher who said, could you please try to get her to read something other than outer space? And her mother said, I could really use some help here. This isn't working for me either. But Carol had this enormous intellect at a very young age, and sometime in high school she had a guidance counselor, as you know, who said, you're good at language, why don't you go to Georgetown? And that had never been, I think, on her horizon or on your grandparents. And she came as a day hop, and it was a challenge. She talked about not knowing what to wear. This was 1960. She was coming into a school that had a lot of people of privilege, and she was not one of them. And she suffered. But there's a picture that we unearthed at the memorial service of your mom in a ball gown. It's a strapless ball gown, and she's swilling a bottle of beer. And she's going to conquer the planet. And we know she did. And as you say, from Bolivia, and she didn't sit around in Bolivia. She said that the classes weren't very good, so she hitchhiked on a boxcar all over Latin America in 1965 as a single woman. I mean, this kid's tough as nails. And then once again, your grandmother said, time to come home and join the typing pool. And she said, no, I'm going to London School of Economics. I mean, what resolve? An only child of these working class parents. So, you know, that was so extraordinary. Her love of all things international. She was tapped, obviously, for the Carter administration to be Deputy Secretary of State for African Affairs. That was formative. I mean, I met her in 1991 when she was pregnant with you. And we were working at Georgetown, and she had just come out of the Carter administration. She was somebody you knew you wanted to be with. I mean, I didn't just want to be with her, I wanted to be her, because that's who she was. She was so bright and so captivating. And then, of course, as Melanne referenced, you know, she went back into USAID and really was a pivotal character there. But more than anything, when she came back to Georgetown and managed to do everything from Mortara Center to running the MSFS program to ascending to the deanship, she was fun. She was fun to be with because she brought smart people to her, and she made you feel as though you were one of them. And she would assemble these amazing dinner parties. I think a lot of you in this room have been there. In the winter, it was a slightly overcooked leg of lamb with roast potatoes, but the piece de resistance was always dessert because she'd bring out the ice cream cart and seven or eight of them with spoons in them. And that was just, you know, that was utter bliss. I mean, I couldn't imagine that there was anything better. And then, you know, even in your daily encounters, we were neighbors, so crossing the street one time, I was on my way to the Sunday market, and I was going to go by the Quakers, where I like to go on Sunday, and she said, why do you do that? And I said, well, it's quiet, and they sit and they reflect. And she said, why can't you do that in a bar? I really contemplated quitting the Quakers. I mean, it was like, so fundamentally life-changing. I thought, amazing. But, you know, when she became ill, the kinds of things that, you know, that amazing mind, she said that she was actually interested and excited in some ways to figure out what came next. And I'll never forget, after her initial treatment, one of the most interesting conversations I ever had with anybody, not just your mother, but with anybody, was after the Russians had annexed Crimea. She went on for 45 minutes about the annexation and what this would mean to the Baltic states and how it was jeopardizing Poland and, you know, how could this happen and what we needed to do. And then she paused for a moment. She said, you know, but nobody really gives a rat's ass about Cremora. And I thought, is she's pulling my leg or did we just go off a pulley? And she said, gotta go now. I went to take a nap. And that was the, you know, the enormity of her great brain. And I, you know, I'm so grateful that we all had that.
Well, you were very helpful, all of you were, in finishing the book, and I couldn't have done it without you. And it was a great honor to work with you on that. So thank you for those reflections.
And everybody should buy it.
And everyone should buy it.
Oh, I don't get yeah, everybody should buy it.
Supporting me.
You know, Douglas, there's a great passage here. This, do you want to read this one, which is my favorite?
Sure, go right ahead. Yeah. You want me to read it?
I could.
Go ahead.
Okay, it says, I've written a book about a city that in some profound sense owns me. I present the city from my perspective as a middle-class white professional who celebrates this place because of family and familiarity, because I am interested, amused, annoyed, and sometimes inspired by the political theater and intellectual life of Washington, because of the diverse and vibrant cultural life of the city and its expanding amenities, and because of its natural beauty, which often and sometimes unexpectedly claims my attention and calms my soul. I think it's safe to say that her soul rests well here in this city and in this institution she loved, and certainly in this book.
Well said, well said. I think, if it's all right with you guys, I think we can turn to some audience questions, perhaps, if there are any.
Or comments about Carol.
Or stories.
Stories about
keep it,
Carol.
Keep it good. I think Jack in the back
keep
there.
Keep it good.
As husband of Gail Griffith, I was also a neighbor of Carol's, and I was also I'm a first generation Washingtonian. Our four children were born in the same hospital. So Carol did not look to me for any intellectual engagement, but she loved to talk about the city because she knew that I was just crazy about the city. And over my nearly 60 years, you know, I'm extremely proud of what has changed and I'm very upset about what hasn't changed, just like she was. And one day I was telling her, I said, so Gail and I live a block north on T Street and a block east or west. And I said, you know, we live in a historic district, and it's not DuPont Circle. It's called the Stryver District, and mm-hmm. It's an official DC historic district. And I said, for my whole life, and I'm an architect, I should know better about things like this, I thought it was either General Stryver or Congressman Stryver or Senator Stryver. And I finally picked up one of the brochures, and it identified that part of Washington, DC, as the beginning of the black middle class, and so there were dentists, doctors, architects, mm-hmm. and it kind of bled over to Howard University. But our house is literally the southwest corner of a district that I thought probably was named after a white man from Iowa, but it was not that at all. And so the comment is that I'd love to talk about DC with Carol, because mm-hmm. she knew more than I did. But she didn't love D.C. more than, you know, we just would go back and forth and back and forth. My parents were in Anacostia when I was born. So she was a great person to talk about the city with mm-hmm. because she knew so much. Yeah. And every sentence was full of love, mm-hmm. every sentence. But.
Thanks, Jack. I think the experience I've had of sharing this book with my friends is that they all say, wow, most Georgetown graduates, they say, wow, there's so much of the city I didn't know about and yeah. so many neighborhoods that I didn't know were worth visiting or had this incredible history. And aside from the architecture, which she complains about somewhat, the rest of the city has a lot to offer that I think is hidden behind the history of the town.
Well, you really couldn't walk with her any place
That's
because
right.
she would punctuate you know, whatever she was talking about with, oh, by the way, oh, okay, do you know the history of that building? Or do you know how this neighborhood developed? She was a, as much as she was an expert on the things that we all remember her to be an expert and she is known for, she was a real expert on the city. But one of the things that always struck me is her sense of justice. Mm. And she recounts in the book being on a very packed bus of mostly white people, mm-hmm, and a woman who is pregnant gets on the bus, and she, I guess, was close to delivery time. And Carol muses in her recounting that not a single person stood up for her.
She was African American.
African American, yeah. Yes, that was the point, her sense of justice.
Yeah.
And it was at once a love affair with the city and yet an understanding that the city has not achieved what we would all like to see it achieve. And that's still the case today when you listen to Maurice's statistics. But the fact that she then got up for this black woman and that she vividly remembered that all of these years later to write about it.
You know, when you mention that, she also talks about August. And when I first came to Washington, everybody left town in August. And I sort of liked staying here because nobody was here.
Yeah, nobody's here.
But now everybody stays in August. Yeah. So you want to leave because the city is just as packed in August as it was. The other thing, and I'm glad to mention this, is that the book is not just about politics, but if you want a good view of the flora and the fauna, the beauty of Washington, mm-hmm, sometimes I don't pay attention. I walk, my wife and I, we take a lot of walks, and she observes the flowers, the birds, the singing. I grew up in the South, and it wasn't and it was such a horrible, you know, period in place that I just didn't pay attention to things like that. But my wife grew up here in this city, and she pays attention to all that. And so when you read this book of Carol's, you see the beauty. And when people talk about how green Washington is, you really don't, mm-hmm, think,
yeah,
about it.
Yeah.
I can watch.
Yeah,
but
it's beautiful.
But it's just beautiful. And all the, yeah, parks and places to go, and she talks about that and many other places in the building. So it's sort of a limit on just looking at everything. Just when you wake up, listen to the birds sing, mm-hmm, or the chirps, because it is about that as well. Just the beauty of life.
I think that's an interesting thing, too, that you mentioned, because that's where we got the real Carol in many parts of this book. One thing, and Richard Brown, to your great credit, pushing her to finish this book was one of the last things we did together here at Georgetown. And it was a struggle because at that point she was very ill. And the one thing that we knew we wanted was more Carol. I started looking at this manuscript in 2008 and I said, it's got to be more you. That, you know, you have these great recollections. She was very hesitant to do that, but where she does do it, it is the recollections, mm-hmm, the flora.
That's what you remember.
That's what you remember, the buildings, the flora. You're right. I think now that's the way she was so humble. That's where she was comfortable inserting herself.
I want to also commend Richard Brown, who helped get this over the finish line. When he suggested the cover, you know, when you think about books about Washington, it's Washington Monument, Capitol, and that is not this book. This is about the city as it is lived in, not as the kind of halls of power. And so this cover is the beautiful, the real Washington skyline for those, yeah, of us who are living here.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Yes, you, sir.
Thank you. I'm David Steinberg. I started teaching here about 1990. And I came from USAID and Asia Foundation. I thought I would have improved the quality of my work by talking to professors, but I never saw any professors. I saw a lot of students. The only one I saw was Carol, mm-hmm, because her office and mine were two doors apart up on the fifth floor of the Intercultural Center, and nobody else was around. And so we had long, long talks. And at that time, she was very worried. She said, you know, I publish a lot on policy, but the academics don't like this, and I don't think I'll get tenure here. Yeah. Imagine that. But further, just on your family, I met your father first in 1958 in Cambodia, and I knew your grandfather in New York in 1956. Both were in the Asia Foundation at that particular time. So I owe a lot to your family.
Oh,
thank you very much. Thank you. Any additional questions or recollections? I think I see somebody in the, sorry for the mic runner, but.
One second. Doug, it's a privilege to be here, Doug, and congratulations. finishing this book. It's really wonderful to see this dream of hers fulfilled. I remember her talking about it, I think all, as far back as when I started Georgetown in 2006. And one of the things that strikes me is just Georgetown itself was such an intersection of these two worlds that she lived in, of this one rooted very much so in this city that she cared so much about, but also an institution which from her standpoint was really a bit more focused on the world and on the larger picture outside of here. But I wonder if you have any insights as to how, and maybe it's in the book and I look forward to buying and reading it, but any insights as to how she saw Georgetown's role in DC itself, and particularly after spending so much time here?
I think Gail and I could probably talk about that, but I would say for sure that she often remarked to me how much she wanted to see the university, which is known so well for its international engagement, to also be a pillar of of Washington, and to really engage in the community. My experience with Georgetown and the local community is defined by my undergraduate, and it's sort of the tensions between the neighborhoods and whatnot. But I think she really wanted Georgetown to become sort of like a good citizen of the city. Not that it wasn't, but that it, she wanted to push the university to focus on investing in Washington.
Well, she taught a course, as you remember. She taught a freshman seminar in Washington. And I know I went with her once, and we went to Ben's Chili Bowl.
Talk about that, because that's you'd gather your students there.
Yes, and
no wonder it's so successful today.
Well, you know, I was fortunate. Ben's Chili Bowl is run by Mrs. Virginia Lee, and she and her husband started it in the late 40s. And her husband was a man from Trinidad, and the wife was from the Rappahannock area of Virginia. And so, but Mr. Lee died a long time ago. I'd known the family, and so we took Carol there, and so everybody ate their chili dogs and had a great conversation about the city. Mrs. Lee came and was very glad because they shared stories, because Carol knew about the riots and places like that. So, but her whole class was just centered around different aspects of Washington, D.C. So she would have policy people and other people coming in. And it was quite successful, so I decided to do the same thing really in the college where I am. So I have done it a couple of times. It's a wonderful experience of getting kids out in the city. I should tell you that now many professors take their students out in the city and see other things. It's not always been the case. Carol helped. I remember once I invited someone to my class, and I was teaching civil rights at the time. I'm trained in an earlier period, but I was teaching, and then and I brought some civil rights people there. And so a professor said to me, "Well, Maurice, do you think that's good? You're giving over your class to some of these other people?" And so I, you know, when people are silly, I laugh. And so the man, it was silly, and so I laughed at him. And I said, "Let me get this right. If I could bring Jesus Christ here to talk about the Word of God, you're telling me I shouldn't?" And so Carol was very much the same thing. And so so we did, and in our department, another, we started taking people out and bringing people to the city. And I think it really, and now pretty much everyone does it, because it's very important for the students. So many students are active in parts of the city, but just hit and miss. And so now this is the idea of going to see the museums. And Carol and I talked about that. Getting on a train and going to Harper's Ferry, it takes 90 minutes. Or going to Mount Vernon, where you think about it, but it has the great exhibit of George Washington slaves, wonderful exhibit there. There's so many things there. And Carol started taking her students. And it's so important now for the student body in itself. And it's so important for students to become citizens of the world. They have to go into the world. And I was very active in the movement in many years. And I was always fascinated by someone who would get more glory if they would go to a place many miles away than they would in the inner city. And I was, I had been asked to work with this Committee on African American Affairs, and I sort of, for the city, and I sort of hesitated for a moment because I knew that if I were going into a village in Outer Mongolia, I'd be praised. But I was just going to talk about black folks in Washington, D.C. It didn't mean much to a lot of people. But it did mean a lot to people like Carol, and that's the point, that life is life and people are people. And as you look today, and I Well, you know, you can look at me and sort of, you know, I'm black, I'm of a certain age, so I'm not a conservative man. So life just didn't give it to me. So Carol would certainly be upset today as she saw conditions and as Africa suffers, as Africa starves, and as the first place that money is taken away from is from the food programs in Africa, which has a great impact on people throughout the world. So it's a lot to think about, and it's a lot to think about of necessity for more people like Carol today who fought for those particular things. Now is the time to fight for that food aid and things.
You know, I think one of the reasons that she was such a passionate champion of global development was because she didn't see a sharp disconnect between the development we had to do in our own country and the improvements we needed to make. And her laboratory was Washington. Her experience was Washington. She saw what wasn't working here and what needed to change, and the fact that kids are in this constant cycle of getting a mediocre education unless somebody enables them to break out of that. This bothered her. And I think it infused her scholarly work with a passion that isn't often there. No offense to some faculty members, but hers was a real humane engagement with what she worked on academically. And, you know, she also writes about the demonstrations. You know, those were some cataclysmic times, particularly later in the 60s. And it was, we have to get engaged. And one of the ways you do it is in your backyard. But she got the fact that there had to be this connectivity, and this was not an island here. Mm-hmm. This place had to be connected with the rest of the city and with the rest of the world.
She definitely believed passionately, and I think both of you have articulated it, in that people were people, right? And that getting to know them and connecting with them is what it's all really about. And in the same way, she tried to do that with the city. She almost viewed the city as an organism to understand, to get to know.
And I have a question for you. As I was reading the book, and I didn't know. So on one side, the parents, of course, from Italy, but how did she become a Methodist is what I want.
I think the other side is all from Germany, and at some point they converted, I guess. I don't know. To be honest, the Lancaster side is one that kind of loses itself in the dust of the Appalachian Mountains somewhere. I tried very hard to do family genealogy, but we just couldn't pick up the threads, to be honest with you.
There's no Methodist bar that I know of.
I don't think
well,
so.
She also said that her mother was far more concerned when Carol went to Georgetown, that she would turn into a papist.
Right.
That's right.
Other kind of dissimilarities that existed.
Right. Her mother said, please don't marry a Catholic. Instead, she married an Iraqi Muslim.
That's right.
Her parents didn't really know what that was, so they were okay with that at the time. but that shows you how far we've come in her lifetime, certainly.
And how expansive her life was.
Right, yeah. Exactly.
I think she had a reflection about Georgetown, too, that would have played itself out to this earlier question about how did she view Georgetown in the world. She had begun to work on a syllabus for the centennial of the School of Foreign Service. That was really intriguing. She and Tony Aaron were planning to teach a course that would start at the beginning of the school and reflect upon the school's role in the world at those various junctures. And she had a very deep interest in this and wanting to make sure that the school got its due credit. And I think that would have been an interesting, certainly would have been an interesting one credit course.
Sure. I think we probably have time for one more question if there is one, anyone? The back there.
She was also very deeply committed to and enfranchisement for Washington, D.C., and disturbed by the fact that we still didn't have it. If she were here with us, what would she tell us that we need to do to ensure that Washington, D.C. is enfranchised?
Wow, what a question. I don't know. I guess that's a tough one. Does anybody want to take a stab?
Well, I mean, to me, Carol's middle name was Engage.
Right.
So I think any way that one could be engaged, whether on the statehood issue, the expanding the franchise issue, voting representation issue. She would be there, she would be for it, and she would say, you need to care.
And I think she would realize that everything is not in the political realm. I mean, the fact is that statehood, won't be here for a while. So what do? Nothing? So we do many things. And I think the university engagement in Washington, I think, I think people haven't looked at it carefully enough. But when the president says that we will start an institution for the study of race and racial justice, and we would start an institute for that study in Washington, D.C., that is something Carol would have been very much a part of, because that is part of the whole mission. So as we look back on the conditions, as we look back on Georgetown's role in slavery, all these things come up. And I think Carol would have been glad that the university is delving in that, but not just delving into it as a glorification, because it's not that. But to look into it as to is to say that we can now engage into the city. We can now right the wrongs, if it's possible. We can now work with more and more African-Americans, and we can bring more and more African-Americans. If you look at the numbers, and I have to be very careful about how I say this, because I don't want to be. If you look at the numbers, so few African-American men are going to college, it breaks your heart. You will have more and more people of African, Caribbean, African, and that is part of because of the upbringing, because of many may have gone to boarding schools, maybe in the old British system and things like that, education. And some African American family tradition has not been that long. I was the first in my family to go to college. My daughter said to me once, "Dad, do you know that I'm the first woman on your side of the family to finish college?" I'd never thought about it, so she had something to say. And this is 2007 when she finished. But I think Carol would say that we have to become more engaged in the city socially and culturally and politically. And it doesn't mean little things, but it means real engagement by the school, by bringing more and more African Americans in the school, by having more things that are in the university. So now the university is engaging. I think they do play with Lorraine Hansberry's play and things like that. All this is a part of that, I think, Eileen. And so we can't sit down and wait, because if you sit down and wait for statehood, I'm afraid, Georgetown would be, how old is Georgetown now? 400 years old. So we better get busy.
When I talked to her about it, I remember she would identify the structural problems that prevent that from happening, which we could go into at length, but you're all aware of them. But as you all said, just because you can identify the problems, there's no silver bullet. It's just continuous effort towards a goal, and I think that's the way she lived her life, and certainly the way she would have addressed that problem.
Mm-hmm. And you were the apple of your mother's eye. She talked about him incessantly, so she would not be the least bit surprised that you helped finish this book.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks, everyone, for coming. Thank you. Thank you.